Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm trying to make a couple of videos tonight, separate ones. Where do I begin? Well, you know, I guess I'll probably title this video about the chemtrails and what's the ultimate purpose of chemtrails. You know, the Lord has been showing me lots of stuff about this kind of thing, and I just haven't made a video about it. So I said, you know what, I need to make it. Ultimately, brothers and sisters, we can look at the things that would cause chemtrails or a lot of people, I don't know why people have their head in the sand, but all you have to do in the United States is, and I don't know about other countries, maybe in Europe too, but if you go outside on any day, amazingly, even in the wintertime, like today, you can go out and you'll see these lines in the sky. Like today, they made a tic-tac-toe pattern. You know, there was lines going this way and lines going that way, like a bunch of H's or squares or whatever. I've been seeing them chemtrailing down here the last couple of days. Now, the most I saw chemtrails every day in Las Vegas. If you don't believe in chemtrails, like I said, there's contrails. Airplanes normally have some smoke coming behind them, or the vapor is freezing or whatever at the different altitude, because a byproduct of combustion engine, or you know the breakdown of the gasoline is water. So you'll see these vapor trails or contrails, but chemtrails, they actually spray in different metals in there. Now you can see videos like what in the world are they spraying and all this to see about that. And you can go look at the sky during the day and see it where you are. Like Las Vegas, I saw it a lot, probably the worst, and I haven't seen that much down here. But the last week, they've been chemtrailing down here, south of here, down toward Charleston, South Carolina. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you can go look this up and see it's real. There's no natural occurring patterns of checkerboards across the sky, then it turns to clouds, it spreads out and turns to clouds. This is not a natural occurrence. And no, the planes aren't flying in patterns and things like that to lay there. And the contrails disappear after just, you know, you can see it. The trail out of the back of the plane way up in the sky, you know, for like 10% of the sky, and then it disappears. This stays and spreads out and covers and turns to clouds. That being said, there are several things that they, you know, that the scientists and the Department of Defense people and all these people that are working on it, brothers and sisters, they have different reasons why it may be being done. But I want to get to the real reason and the ultimate reason why it's being done. But those reasons, just to go through it, you know, these are true. That doesn't make one reason wrong and then it's only this reason. It's many reasons. They want to modify the weather. They want to control the weather. As a matter of fact, we haven't had a hurricane hit the East Coast of the United States, like this is the 10th season, which is really weird. They can use it with the harp, H-A-A-R-P, you know, and there's a video, you know, the angels don't play this harp. You could check that out up there in Alaska, but they use it supposedly to cause an earthquake, so you reflect the waves of the harp to do different stuff, and all of these things I'm mentioning may or may not be true, or they all may be also true, to prevent an EMP attack on the United States from Russia or these other countries. Another theory there is G. Edward Griffith had his, you know, produced some documentaries called What in the World Are They Spraying and Why in the World Are They Spraying? And he's the one who wrote this book called The Creature from Jekyll Island, talking about the setting up of the Federal Reserve. Anyway, one of their theories is, you know, they're trying to kill all the non-genetically modified GMO plants, you know, and then so that way people have to buy these patented genetically modified fruits and vegetables. Now, I want to say this, it's also true about GMOs. The reason why a company would develop GMOs, like as a matter of fact, Monsanto, which is owned by or controlled by, you know, Bill Gates, who hates people, you know, one motive is they want to kill people with it, right? I mean, the satanicness in them. But it's also true they want to have a patent on these DNA alternated plants. And why do they make a DNA alternated plant? It's the same thing with the chemtrails. There's different reasons, and some of them or all of them may be true at the same time, but not the ultimate reason. So let's look at those two, and I didn't even think about that. They started making the video about the seeds. But, you know, there's botanists who say, hey, let's make a corn that's resistant to bugs. You know, that's their motive. So they try to manipulate the DNA so that when, you know, that it has like a built-in natural insecticide. Okay, so they're motivated by that, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's like the one scientists are motivated, oh, there's global warming, we want to cool down the planet. You know, that's their idea, their theory. They want to try to save the planet and all that. You know, that's the theory of some of the people who are working on this project. You know, and there's some, you know, good thoughts in that area, you know, without considering that, you know, they're spraying aluminum and barium and all these other things over us. We don't know what it could do to us. Now, this is all the natural stuff, brothers and sisters. Just like the genetically modified food, when you manipulate that DNA, as they just discovered this year, 2014, you can go look this up too, they discovered that there's at least one more layer of under DNA. We have the traditional DNA sequence that was discovered by Watson and Crick there in the 1950s. But now they've discovered there's a whole nother hidden sequence under the DNA. And they don't even know what it does. And you know what? There's probably a whole lot more layers they don't even know about. You know, it's like a 3D model or whatever. Four-dimensional model or 10-dimensional. They don't know how this all works in God's creation. That's why they come up with black matter or dark matter and black holes and all that, because they're trying to account for all the fact that they don't know where's all the mass, that, you know, we have a certain amount of gravity on Earth. Therefore, there has, you know, by scientific calculations, mathematical calculations and physics and all that, there has to be a certain amount of mass to create the atmosphere, or to create the, you know, the magnetivity, to create the gravity of the Earth and the pull of the planets and all that. You know, they can, you know, they can do constants of measurements of these, of the way the planets go and the gravity on Earth and the gravity on the moon, et cetera, et cetera. And then there, you know, to get those numbers to work, there has to be X amount of matter in the universe, but they can't account for but only like 10% of it. You know, so since they can only account for a little bit of it, then that's why they come up with these theories. So the same thing, DNA. They only know so much, and then they run with the rest of it. That's why evolution and all that is really a joke. The more they study and the more they discover, they find out, hey, everything's a whole lot more complex than what we came up. Even there's a quote by Darwin, who is himself was, you know, was a racist third generation inbred, which that's what they thought. So, you know, that was the end of their, he had an uncle that really wrote the, you know, who wrote a book before him, you know, really where Darwinism comes from. You know, it's basically, you know, we're blue bloods, we're rich people, we're somebody, let's all interbreed and we're going to become perfect. I mean, that was their motive, was racism and superiority complex. You know, Hitler took it to its extreme, you know, extreme end of the master race. I mean, that's where it came from. And Margaret Sanger, who gave us Planned Parenthood, that's taking it to an extreme. Let's wipe out the poor and undesirable, ignorant people that we may rule and reign as gods. You know, so, you know, I'm getting back to the chemtrails and the GMO, genetically modified foods, and all those things. And we get caught up, you know, if you're watching this, maybe you picked up this video because you're, you know, you're into conspiracy theories. You're not a Christian. You're just, you know, whatever, agnostic, atheist, whatever. And you're looking at the natural effect of chemtrails as an example. Let's stay with the original topic here of chemtrails, and it's a modification. There's genetically modified seeds. They're, you know, modifying the atmosphere. They're trying to modify it, making it man-made. Okay, the ultimate level of that, and the reason why they do it is for evil. You know, Jesus said that, you know, evildoers love the darkness and they hate the light. You know, just like in the movies, The Twilight and The Vampire Diaries and all this thing, you know, God is Shekinah light. You know, it says, you know, it's a, like a the bright is a thousand suns. Like when God speaks, it's the sound of many many waters, like a million rushing rivers. And so the light, the Shekinah glory of God, is like the light of a million suns. But S-U-N's. But Satan's light, the Illuminati, for you conspiracy people, it's Illuminati, comes from the Illuminated One. That's where the name Lucifer comes from, the Illuminated One. But you know, his light is more like, you know, the Lord had just dropped all this on me today. I could go with a thousand parts of this. All this wisdom. Praise the Lord for the wisdom of God that confounds the wise of this world, brothers and sisters. It's awesome. It's like this, brothers and sisters. If you were in the middle of the, you know, the desert at night and it's dark, you know, you could go see a campfire. You know, that's like the light of Satan. It's like a campfire in the middle of the night in the darkness. And you go there, or like in a restaurant with candlelight. You could be sitting in a restaurant, you know, that's, you know, the ambiance of the restaurant is like a candlelit dinner, even if you went at lunch. they have a romantic candlelight dinner, and you just got the little candle there, and then you get into that little dim light, and it's like, hey, this is nice, it's romantic. There's nothing wrong with eating in a restaurant or romance or any of those kind of things, but it's the ambiance, and there you are, that little candle, and you're like, man, it's so nice in here, and I, you know, and your eyes adjust, and you're like, hey, you know, I can see. You know, the old joke is, you know, they don't want you to see the dirt and the roaches, and they don't want you to see the food, you know, so they have the candles and keep it dim in there, but, you know. Anyway, so, but when you, if you were to be there at lunchtime, and you're in there and enjoying it, and then you go out, and the sun's out, it's like hurting your eyes. You're blinded, right? So that's the difference, brothers and sisters. People who have rejected the light of God, which is a bright, boom, that's why we're to be salt and light. You know, when you start evangelizing an atheist or something, and the light, you know, it's just like someone that's been sitting in the dark, and you turn on that bright spotlight, you know, 10,000 candle white, you know, light bulb in their face, man, a spotlight, they get angry. It hurts, man. It's like, turn off that light. It's annoying and frustrating because, you know, you're not used to light, and this is a overwhelming light of truth, as Jesus said. He's the light of the world. The S-O-N, and then you got the S-U-N is what we're talking about. We're looking at the natural, the dualities. You know, God always uses me, brothers and sisters, if you watch my videos, about the dualities of things, S-O-N and the S-U-N. You know, light and dark. You know, the oppositions and the yin and the yang, the conflict of light and dark, brothers and sisters. So we look at good versus evil, brothers and sisters. So, vampires and all that stuff, there's a grain of truth in that. They love darkness. So therefore, ultimately, they want to dim the earth. And they even say, you can Google this and look it up. I can't remember now the exact figures, but you know, the world's light has been dimmed. Even in the universe here, brothers and sisters, there's a dimming in the universe, in all of the galaxy in the universe. Not just in our galaxy, but the whole universe. There's a, you know, there's like a dimming of light. You know, there's been scientific articles about that. Not just the chemtrails here on Earth. So brothers and sisters, even though there's scientists who work on it and they have their different motives, and the Department of Defense has different motives of why they do the chemtrails and why we have genetically modified seeds. You know, even people, as I said, scientists who want to eliminate, you know, having to use pesticides. They build it into the DNA of the corn. That corn, by the way, has been escaped. Bees have cross-pollinated that stuff, and those genetically modified foods have escaped. The government has passed rules saying that they don't have to label it, that it's been genetically modified in cereals and all that stuff. Horrible. That's why consumers need to complain and force, you know, General Mills and Kellogg's and all them, whomever, to label it, this has genetically modified or not, or genetically modified free. They got gluten-free everywhere, which is only affects 1% of the population or 2% or whatever. They should have genetically modified free, you know, and that's why we need to get the companies to do it voluntarily, out of consumer pressure. But that's in the natural, brothers and sisters. And lots of you brothers and sisters who talk to me and comment to me, you're all bound up in those natural things about the chemtrails. But the greater truth, brothers and sisters, the devil wants to turn down the lights in the natural and in the spiritual. All these things go hand in hand. You know, they do become literally, physically light sensitive, like vampires, because of the wickedness in them. And they're also, of course, photophobic. That's the word. That's not, you know, that's a real phobia. Photophobia is not afraid of having your picture taken, like, you know, a vampire. Oh my, you know, or somebody that thinks that, you know, the camera will steal their soul, or a vampire who's afraid to have, he won't show up in the picture, like in the movies. But someone who has photophobia is they are afraid of the sun. They're afraid of light, and so that's what we have. They're photophobic because of the wicked evil in them. But yet they want illumination, like the torch of, you know, the Statue of Liberty. They want that, you know, the illumination of the Illuminati, the Lucifer, that dim light, not the bright Shekinah. You know, there is no, in God, there is, the Bible says in the King James, I love the way it says it, if I can remember exactly, say it right, you know, in God, there is no darkness and, you know, no shadow of turning. So in other words, when you turn, you know, you'll make a shadow and there'll be like, you know, a shadow as you turn around or whatever, but with God, He is light, and there's no shadow of turning in God. I mean, it's like the Bible says in heaven, you know, God is the source of light. It's not like, oh, there's the light of God, and point, you know, like the sun, the sun that we have in our solar system. It's not like that. It's everywhere. He's everywhere. You know, God is everywhere, omnipresent. God is omnipresent, so His light is everywhere from every angle. There is no darkness in God, brothers and sisters. That's why, when you know, even in, to you know, to put that into practical application in our lives, and you know, in the spiritual things, not even about chemtrails, but you know, it's like if you got darkness in your life, you know, don't try to push the darkness out of your life. You got to run into the light. You know, it's not unlike in the movie Poltergeist, where it said, you know, don't go toward the light. With God, we go toward the light, go into the light. Then when you're in Him, the darkness has to flee. It's like this, brothers and sisters. I told this, analogy a long time ago. If you went into a room with a bunch of lights in there, a really, really bright lit up room, especially if you have white walls and stuff, you know, it really reflects, you know, like in the movies or whatever, somewhere you have this bright white room with a big bright lights, and you put somebody in there, and I was to have a box, and I had a little, like a shoe box or a jewelry box, and I closed that jewelry box. Now, inside that jewelry box, it's dark, right? I could go out at night and open up the jewelry box and close it. Now, this jewelry box is closed. It's full of darkness. It's nighttime inside there. I take the jewelry box into that bright room with the light, and I open the box, and nothing happens. The room is still bright. The light enters the box. Now the box is no longer dark because I opened it up. Boom! Now the box has light in it, right? Now, if I take that same box and I put a candle in it, or a light like a flashlight, because it might burn up with a candle, I put a flashlight inside the box and turn it on, and I cover it up. Now there's light inside there. And then I take it into a dark room, a room that's totally sealed off and the walls are painted black. You know, like the Rolling Stones, they paint it black, the room's black, there's nothing in there. I go in there, close all the doors, totally sealed, total blackness, darkness. I opened up the shoebox and boom, the light from the flashlight fills the room, right? Brothers and sisters, we got to go to the light. The power is in the light, not in the darkness. You know that darkness, you know, as Paul tells us when he talks about the rapture, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and then he talks in chapter 5, he said, you know, he talks about that the day would overtake those who are in the darkness, but we are not children of the dark, but we're children of the light, that day should not overtake us as a thief, that we would be prepared and be ready. Brothers and sisters, we do not know the exact day of the rapture. No man knows the day or the hour, but we'll know the season. And we, brothers and sisters, those of you who watch this, who are awakened in the light, and that's why, you know, the Lord led me to make this about the chemtrails, which it is that some people who are in the dark about God would come into the light because they've already rejected that bright light. They ran out into the darkness, and they see a campfire on the horizon or a torch light. Man, they run to that light because it's not so strong. You know, if you were to stand around, let's just say this. Why do you think they keep those discos dimly lit? Because all the ugly people, right? I mean, you go in there and like they say, you know, you put on your beer goggles. You know, people that are not a Christian, or, you know, a lot of us in our former days, in our days before we became a Christian, we were backsliders or, you know, never wases. And we go into you go into one of those clubs, and they keep the lights dim. You get drunk, you know. You put on your beer goggles, so so you can see. People begin to look better with your beer goggles on. And as a matter of fact, they say that's the definition of ugly. You drink six beers, and the person is still a one on a scale of 1 to 10. But anyway, just only a joke. So anyway, when you go in there, they have the lights dim, and then you know you see people there. They look pretty good, you know. But when you go outside with them, or you go to, you know, if you were to go to their house or take them home, you know, back in those days, you know, you go home with somebody, then you got the bright lights on. You're like, whoa, wait a minute. Whoa, 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 ease up, ease up, ease up. I think I came to the wrong house, right? So, you know, I'm just using this as an illustration, brothers and sisters, that is practical to all of us, because most people were not been walking with the Lord since childhood. Some of you have, praise God, God bless you. But lots of us, we have our sinful past. That is nothing to be proud of, but we can use it for practical application and learning, brothers and sisters. So this is an example. But so when people who are living in sin, and they got lots of sin and baggage in their life, they want to stay around that, you know, the dimly lit campfire in the lights of the discotheque or the you know, because it's dimly lit. So, you know, when they're in the light of Lucifer, the lulling, lazy light of Lucifer, they cannot, you know, see themselves. They look at themselves, they're like, man, my shirt looks white, it looks clean. I look clean. You know, I'm looking handsome, I'm looking beautiful, I'm looking good in the lazy, lulling, looser, illuminating light of Lucifer. When they would go into the Shekinah, bright, 10 times, a million times brighter than the sun, light of the Holy Spirit of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son, S-O-N, then they would say, whoa, wait a minute, I thought my garments were white as snow, but actually they're very, very off-white. They're dingy, gray, stinking, filthy, you know, sins. I'm full of filthiness. I need to be washed, not in Clorox, not washed in Tide, and all of these things are washed in Dove soap, but washed in the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Messiah. Amen. Have you been to Jesus for that cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. You know, if you go read Isaiah chapter 1, it says, come now, let us reason together. God says he wants to reason with you. Though your sins be as scarlet, you know, red, they shall be white as snow. Even though they're, you know, they're looked like blood, they're red, like crimson, they shall become white as snow. Now you imagine, have you ever heard of taking blood and washing something? You know, human blood, you know, is a stain. But with God being stained with the blood of Jesus, anointed, that's what anointed means. You're a chrismata. We talk about the Holy Spirit, but it's also, you know, to be rubbed on. You know, it comes really, we're talking about the Holy Spirit, but it's also the blood of Jesus. The Roman soldiers would take their shields and rub in oil, leather shield, and they would rub oil into that leather shield, olive oil, to make it, you know, resistant, protected. That's what it is, the chrismata, to be anointed with oil. But in this case, before you can be anointed with oil, you have to be anointed with the blood of Jesus and washed in the blood. Hallelujah. Have you been washed in the blood of the Lamb? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Hallelujah. That's the question. Hallelujah. That's the question. Hallelujah means praise Yahweh, the Father, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The chemtrails are a natural reminder that we are living in the end times. It's a natural reminder that the devil would love to block the light of the sun. That's why so many in the church have fallen away. They're no longer salt and light. But as Jesus said, they're ready for the dunghill. They're no longer salt and light, but dung and night. They were salt and light, but they've lost their savor. They've become dung, as Jesus said, or manure, and night, not salt and light. Many have become that, brothers and sisters. They've waxed cold. They've fallen away. They've turned their back on Jesus. They're like the New York police has done the mayor. You know, they've turned their back on him. But that's a whole different case because, you know, we don't get into that in the natural. But many people, instead of turning their eyes upon Jesus, have turned their back on Jesus. They've turned their heart to the world. Just like Lot's wife. People keep trying to exalt, and for some reason, there's been a lot of these denominational backsliders. Lukewarm Christians have been trying to debate with me, and they keep justifying Lot. Lot himself took his family. He originally pinched his tents. He pitched his tents towards Sodom. And then later on, we find him living in Sodom. And God delivered him because of his uncle, Abraham. God delivered Lot because of his uncle who had interceded for him. And God delivered him, but, you know, his wife turned back and looked, she loved Sodom. His sons-in-laws loved Sodom. Only Lot went out with his two of his daughters. They were the only ones to escape. He lost everything. Unlike Abraham, his uncle, who kept himself separated from the world. This is a whole other video I'm talking about. Abraham kept himself separated from the world and stayed on top of that, the other land. He even let his nephew choose. Even though he was the older, he should have been honored and respected. But he told his nephew, hey, which, you know, you want to go this way, you can have that side. If you want to go this way, you can have that side. Of course, his nephew took what he thought was the best place. Instead of honoring his uncle, who was the man of God, he took the prominent, what he thought was the prominent land. Lost everything because he fell in love with the world. Lost everything. That's what's going to happen to the lukewarm Christians. That's that video I made that's been seen by over 100,000 people. That's the whole message in a nutshell. The Lord showed me who would be raptured and who would not. It's not individuals. As some trolls would say, am I going to be raptured or not? No. God didn't show me all the individuals, but what groups of people would be raptured and which not? Those who are walking with the Lord, those wise virgins, not those foolish virgins. Wise virgins are keeping themselves separated from the world. They see chemtrails for what they are. They see most of these denominations for what they are. They've come out from among them. And then those foolish virgins, like what Lot did, all loved up and mingling with the world and with the flesh so much that you would let your daughters marry wicked men. His daughters were marrying, his daughters were betrothed to local people who didn't believe what their father-in-law was telling them. His wife loved the world so much that she turned her back to the Lord and looked upon the city and was turned to a pillar of salt. These were all supposed to be children of God. Only Lot escaped by the skin of his teeth, as they say. I know it's a whole other message, but I guess it's connected under here, brothers and sisters, you know, to my message. Praise God as he would lead us by his Holy Spirit. You know that I love you guys. I praise the Lord for every one of you who watches my videos. I appreciate every one of you who I've had the privilege of ministering to and administer to me. You know, many of you have sent me private messages and been a blessing to me in so many ways. People that have sponsored the orphans and helped build the orphanages and the feeding programs and all those things. And the anointing oil, praise God, we're up to about 20. I personally know of about 20 people that were healed from the anointing oil that God led us to make and pray over. Many of you guys prayed in agreement with me. Our prayers are, our fervent prayers are effective. The Bible says the fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. King James, James chapter 5. We have prayed over that anointing oil, James chapter 5. And as elders in the body of Christ, that anointing oil has been of much effect, brothers and sisters. One day I'll do a video going through all those. Even animals, which, you know, that's, you know, I'm not a, you know, an overactive animal lover. But there's many of you who are, and they've used anointing oil for animals, at least like 3 or 4 different people. And their animal was healed, too. I mean, you know, it's up to, hey, the Lord is awesome. You know, God created everything in the creation, and animals are part of his creation, and God loves animals. God loves those things we love. As Christians, I know I'm changing topics again, but if we love our dog, God knows that. God loves us. He wants us to, you know, to have those things in our life. God is a blessing. That's why, you know, that's still a whole other topic. Talk about animals in heaven and all that. No, animals aren't humans, and no, they're not, you know, getting saved and all that. But we as Christians, God loves us. And he gives us the desires of our heart, the Bible says. And if you want to have a puppy dog with you in heaven, I don't see any reason why the Lord won't let you have a puppy dog. Because he loves us. He wants to give us good gifts. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not that he's, you know, the dog got saved and so he's in heaven. No, dogs don't have a spirit like we do. They have, you know, they don't have the spirit in the image of God. They're animals. But God would let us have them there because he loves us. God wants us to be blessed in this life and in the life to come. God said, you know, his mansions for us. And eyes have not seen or ears have heard the things that God has prepared for those who love him. You know, they're like my grandpa. He was a dairy farming freak. He was a cow-loving freak. You know, sometimes we were talking when I was a teenager, me and my cousins, and we were talking about women and, you know, beautiful women. And my grandpa was with us, and we just got up some hay on my grandpa's farm. This is in Southern Virginia. And my grandpa said, well, you know what my definition of beautiful is? A bright green field filled with a bunch of Guernsey cows, you know, and that to him was beauty. So, you know, someone at his funeral, one of my uncles said, you know, he knows that if God gives us the desires of our heart, my grandpa's got cow, you know, dairy cows there in heaven, you know, and that's how God is. He blesses us with what we like, you know. I'm changing topics. I guess I should make another video. You know, brothers and sisters, I had a dream one time. I think I mentioned this a long time ago. Actually, I have one grandmother that's still alive. She's like 88 or 89 years old. But in my dream, she was in heaven, and I was in heaven. I didn't know I was in heaven at the beginning of my dream. But in my dream, I went to her house to actually ask her for some, to borrow some of this, this local stuff here. They have country ham. It's local in the southeastern part of the United States. It's like ham, but it's really kind of salty, and it's called country ham. I think now it's spreading out across the United States, but you could used to only get it like Georgia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Virginia, maybe, and Kentucky and Tennessee, just in this area. Now it's spreading out more. I heard now you can get it in Dallas. And I think that's pretty new. But anyway, in my dream, I went to my grandma's house to get to borrow some, to ask her for some of this country ham. And when I went to her house, when I got to her house, because I didn't know I was in heaven in the dream, and she's still alive, you know, and I'm still alive. But, you know, I believe it was just the Lord showed me that she would, you know, be in heaven. And when I went to her house, I noticed that her house looked like her house, but it also looked like the farmhouse that my grandparents lived in for like 25 years. My grandfather leased a farm in Virginia, a dairy farm. And it looked like that house, but it also looked like their house in our family homestead, our family land. It's been in my family for like a couple, you know, 150, 200 years. It looked like that house too. And I was like, well, it looks like both houses at the same time. But I couldn't figure it out. It was just perfectly seamed together where it looked like both. So I went into the house, and then when I looked at the floor, it looked like both houses inside. But when I began to look at the tile, you know, like at the floor, it was all these designs in it. And it was like infinity. Looking through the designs and the tiles on the floor was like looking into infinity. And it was so beautiful. And the detail was on it, like I could periscope down into it and see all these details on and on and on into infinity. I was like, man, this is crazy. And then I was in the living room, and it looked like both rooms, both houses, but I could see the room was like a normal-sized room. But when I started walking across the room was was infinity. The room was like, you know, 1,000 miles across. But yet when I stood in it, it looked like it was whatever, you know, 20 by 20 or whatever the size of the room would be. But it was both at the same time, and it looked like both houses at the same time. And all, everything was like that. And then when my grandma gave me the country ham, it was like she gave me 1 pound of it, but yet I had 1,000,000 pounds of it. You know, it was like Jesus multiplying the bread and the fish. I had that small amount that I needed, like even the manna. It said when people collected the manna that fell from heaven, even though if they collected one omar, which like a one measure of it, and someone collected a half omar, but when they ate, it was all they wanted. You know, it was all they could eat. You know, it never got empty while they were eating it. So the same thing with that, with everything in heaven. It's like the supply you need is there, but yet it was an infinite supply. You see what I'm saying? So that was kind of the message that the Lord was showing me. It's been a long time ago, and I made a video about it way back 3 or 4 years ago. But anyway, brothers and sisters, as usual, I've covered many topics, because if I don't do it, I'll forget. I'm knocking the table. If I don't put it in this video, I'll forget, and then, you know, what can you do? So that's my PS, postscript, PSS. So I guess I had two or three there. Anyway, brothers and sisters, again, you know, if you're watching this video, you can look at the timer and say, if I say I'm done, and you say, where's 10 more minutes left? Then you know. But me, while I'm making it, I don't know. So I can say, well, this is it, brothers and sisters, but it's not. I don't know that while I'm making it. Anyway, God bless you guys. I appreciate you guys. As I said in the video I loaded, I made before this one, which I will load first. By the grace of God, we've been praying about going to the Philippines to build another orphanage. As everything seems to be coming together to do that, I'm open and ready to go or not go. It's up to the Lord if it'll come together or not. It's all in His good timing. I ask you guys to pray about that and pray for us, you know, to do the will of the Lord in that, to go this year, to go or not to go. That is the question. This year. And God bless you guys. I ask you guys to pray too, because I've been asking the Lord, you know, about pastoring a church here in the States, a physical locale church or not. It's totally up to the Lord. When, where, why, and how. Or continue with the virtual church, you know, and then of course the ministry in the Philippines. You know, so the advantage of the virtual church is I can go back and forth to the Philippines if need be, and I can still make videos like I did before, back and forth. And that seems to make total sense. But if I had a, you know, the Lord would let me, you know, have a physical church and I work with people in a physical location, then I can disciple them better, meet with them personally and pray and do a whole lot more in that, you know, concentrated thing. So there's good and bad in all the above, which is best and which is not. Because if I have a physical church, then it, you know, would limit me on being able to go to the Philippines and all these kind of things. So I ask you to pray about that. What's the Lord's will and all that? And I thank you guys. I love you guys. I appreciate you guys. And I'm going to make a video later on praying for you guys and get ready for New Year's Eve here, New Year's Day, whenever you want to, fast. I'm going to fast at least 24 hours. Probably I just drink, usually when I fast, I drink black coffee. That's it. And water. Some people don't drink anything but water. Some people drink nothing. It's up to you. You know, there's no set rules on it. You can just eat, but then not watch TV or anything else and just read your Bible and pray the whole 24 hours, whatever. Praise the Lord. You know, stay awake the whole 24 hours. You know, fast from sleeping. You know, or whatever, for 24 hours, if you can, as the Lord leads you. Any of those things are a fast. Any way you want to do it, you're sacrificing something that you love to do or normally do and spend that time dedicated to the Lord. Any, you know what I'm saying? That's a fast, really. Seeking God and putting something aside. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless.